On today's show,
we discuss the Celtics' Game 2 victory, LeBron's neck injury, and if JR deserved to be ejected.
Former Cavs GM David Griffin joins us on set to talk Cavaliers.
And in Crossfire, we debate the biggest winners and losers from the NBA draft lottery.
It's Wednesday, May 16th. The search starts now.
Evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters, presented by Jack Daniel's Tennessee Honey. Whether you're joining us live right now on NBA TV, watching later on YouTube, listening to the podcast, doesn't matter. We're very happy to have you. I'm Jay Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tess Millis.
Thank you for joining us.
To his right, the international man of mystery, taking it to the max, Lee Ellis.
Friend.
Lily.
Lily, and last, certainly not least, over yonder, that is the bearded one, looking fresh today, that's Trey Kirby.
Ayo!
What's up, TK?
Well, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at hashtag the starters. And guys, one of the signature moments of the Celtics game to win was Marcus Morris's and one on Tristan Thompson, takes him to the hole, finishes it through contract, then flexes and screams right in his face. Ah! This instantly became a meme. The internet was going nuts. And it brings us to today's question. What was Marcus Morris yelling about? For instance, if you have a toddler at home, surely you've seen something like this. I want a special treat is big in my house right now. Or maybe he was yelling, it clearly says Laurel. Or perhaps, Bitcoin isn't actually worth anything, though I guess that could have been Tristan Thompson yelling that, to which Marcus Morris responded, neither does paper money. We all just agree it has value. Same with Bitcoin. But we want to hear from you, so let us know on Twitter, what was Marcus Morris yelling about? Send us your best tweets to hashtag the starters. We'll hear from you later.
All right, get your tweets in. What constitutes a special treat right now?
Big special treats in our house right now would be a Fig Newton or a single jelly bean. Wow. Easy to please.
Yeah, very easy. All right, we got a fun show tonight. Former Cavs GM David Griffin is going to swing back by the studio. We'll talk to him about the Cavs, a slow start here in the Eastern Conference Finals. We got Tass and Trey going head-to-head in Crossfire to talk about the draft lottery. We got Lili's very solid play, but let's start with some true or false. Game 2, Eastern Conference Finals. TK, let's do it.
Garden Gang, Garden Gang, Garden Gang, Garden Gang. The Celtics won again last night, taking Game 2 against the Cavs in Boston to push their record at home this postseason to 9-0. Cleveland led by 7 at the half, but Boston got their cuz cries on and blew the Cavs out by 20 in the second half. After the game, Ty Lue said the Celtics out-toughed the Cavs.
They're playing tougher than we are. We see that. They're being physical. They're gooning the game up, and we got to do the same thing.
True or false, the Celtics won by gooning the game up.
No,
gooning it up.
No, that's false. They won because they played better. And that's too boring for us to talk about. That's why the Celtics are the new Spurs to me. They don't have these storylines or this infighting within their locker room. The coach often makes bigger headlines than the players.
Yep.
They do it by committee. Everybody's doing their part, just like the Spursies. And even when Kyrie or Gordon Hayward comes back, it feels like Duncan-esque. Like, yeah, they're doing their part, but everybody else is contributing. And they don't give up. They don't stop. And that's the biggest thing. And I think kind of an unheralded part about the Spurs. Second quarter, not having a great time, not having a great game. The Celtics hung on. And that was a turning point to me. You know, it was 11 points towards the end of the second quarter. They made it 7 to go into the locker room. And that's when things started rolling in the third quarter. Those moments are key. And that's what the Spurs were so good at. This team is boring like the San Antonio Spurs. So we need to throw in a little headline, a little thing at the bottom of the screen that says, they were gooning them. They're the best team on the floor. They won 1 through 8. They're better.
You're right about that. I think it's true, though. And people are going crazy over the implied dirtiness of the word goon.
Yeah.
But I think what Lou really meant, and he said it at the beginning of it, they played tougher. And there is no doubt. They played better, but they also played tougher. I'm talking about the Celtics than the Cavaliers.
That's a part of playing
boxing
better,
for sure. Exactly. Boxing out, hitting the floor, rebounding, all those little dirty things that aren't as sexy to talk about. They did them. Every guy on their team did them. And meanwhile, you got the Cavs. Their playoff slogan says whatever it takes. It should just say, meh, whatever. Because that's how they're playing right now. They're like, you know, they're not getting out on shooters there in the second half when things got out of control. They weren't boxing out. You know, Marcus Smart getting these huge offensive rebounds. Just those little things. So, yeah, the gooning it up part, people are going nuts because that means dirty, but he just means tougher, and he's right. So it's true in a weird way to me.
He's kind of referring to the way Marcus Smart plays, I think, as well. Because Marcus Smart is that guy who throws his body on the ground for everything. He's diving, he's fighting, he's scrapping. We know that Marcus Smart isn't a great shooter, but he does so many important things, so many plays for this team, that it keeps him in the game, and it actually energizes his teammates as well, because the Cavs, for 30 to 35 minutes of this game, probably played better than Boston, but it was that last 15 minutes or so where the Celtics just took over. And once they got ahead of the Cavs didn't have that fight back in them. They got behind, had a little bit of a run there, but really the Celtics just put their foot down and Cleveland couldn't keep up. But everyone who came out there was diving, was boxing out, was throwing their body on the line. And a lot of that starts with a guy like Marcus Smart who leads the way and the other guys do it. But incredible performance by Boston.
Yeah, and disappointing from the supporting cast of the Cavs. Oh. Besides LeBron and Kevin Love, who had a good game, it was kind of unheralded, 22 points. They got 30 from the rest of the crew, 64 from the top two dudes, and then 30 from the rest of the guys. This is not going to win you ballgames. And if they're not going to score, they got to out-scrap. Yep. And Marcus Smart obviously brings it every single possession. He is so special to watch for a guy who doesn't score but impacts the game in so many ways. He's really unique in that way.
Coach Lou, he made the coaching change there in game two. Tristan comes in. We had talked about that heading into that game. You know, Korver went to the bench. He hit some shots when he came off the bench in that second quarter. Yep. Tristan gave them a little bit of energy, I thought, early in the game when they built the lead. But you're right. I mean, the starting backcourt for the Cavs, George Hill and J.R. Smith, 3 points. I mean, that's just not going to cut it, especially when the guys on the other side and Terry Rozier and Jaylen Brown, I mean, they're putting up over 40. It's just another abysmal game from these two. Just no consistency at all throughout these playoffs from these guys, you know, except when they play the Raptors, it feels like. Yeah. But so far, you know, in the Pacers series and now here in the Celtics series, you're right. I mean, LeBron and Love last night get no other help. Get no other help. All right, Trey, next one.
After a 21-point first quarter, it looked like LeBron James was going to make Lee Ellis $20 by scoring 50 in game two. But late in the second quarter, LeBron took a shoulder to the face from Jason Tatum, which left him with a strained neck that required a trip to the locker room. He came back, played almost the entire second half, finished with a 42-point triple-double. But true or false, LeBron's neck injury affected him.
I'm not sure what the answer is to this because LeBron came out super aggressive. He was attacking, he was scoring. Trey mentioned the 21 points in that first quarter. He looked great. But in the second half, whether it was fatigue, whether it was this neck injury, he didn't look as aggressive to me. Maybe he was trying to get other guys involved. Maybe saying, listen, I need you guys to perform better. But I felt that LeBron had opportunities to score inside in that second half that he took in the first half, but he wasn't taking those in that second half. So maybe he was some concussed to some level and he was just trying to fight through it. Or he just ran out of gas. It might have been one of those two things. I'm not really sure.
What do you think, Seth?
I think he wanted to see his other guys contribute, and he was just simply tired. I mean, the second quarter, after he had that great first quarter, before he was hit, he also wasn't shooting.
Yeah.
I think he shot 15 shots in the first half and 14 in the second half, so basically equal. And he shot way more threes in the first half, so he wasn't settling, I don't think, in the second half. But I think he was tired. And you saw it on the defensive end, that Terry Rozier three at the end. He wasn't rotating. I think he was just saying to his guys quite often what he does. Is this is your play. They play like a super team, you know, like the Kyrie / LeBron Cavs, where it's just your play. You know, we're not going to run a huge set. Just do something out there, and I'm going to take a play off, and I'm going to take a play off defensively.
But he tends not to do that in a playoff game. He does that in the regular season to send a message when it doesn't really matter if they lose a game. But this was a pretty important game for the Cavs, and I felt in that fourth quarter especially, that demanded, when he wasn't really getting any contributions from anyone other than Kevin Love, that, like, he's going to have to get those points. He may have to go for that 50 that I was hoping for, but because no one else was doing it. And to me, he just looked like he wasn't as aggressive as he was in the first quarter.
Yeah, but what we're getting at was it because he got popped in the head and he was concussed a little bit? Was he just tired? Was he frustrated with his teammates and trying to get some help from them? Or was it all three of those things went in there? I don't think it was just the shot there to the chin. And he was no doubt dazed. Like, there's no doubt. You don't see LeBron go back to the locker room often.
No.
Said he recalibrated, came back. And in that second quarter, he had obviously slowed down from the crazy first quarter before he got popped. And then the second half, 7-14. I mean, he was still doing things. He was still doing things. But in the end, I don't think it really had an impact. I think it was the Celtics outplayed them for sure.
I think he does take plays off just to watch guys go, even in the postseason. I think, you know, we tend to believe this guy's a machine, and it's easy to just say, go at the hole each and every time down the floor. But what is the guy supposed to do? Mm-hmm. I mean, you had a bet going for 50. You should have got better odds. But is he going to go for 50, 55, 60?
But they weren't getting it from anyone else. That's what I'm saying. And when he was attacking Marcus Morrison and whoever in that first quarter, he was either getting fouled or scoring. And I thought that's what he had to do in that fourth quarter just to get some points on the board.
He scored more in the second half than he did the entire game one, though. Like, he did put points on the board.
Yeah, next time you pay me the $20, make it a crisp $20 bill.
Oh, my God.
Not this wrinkled up, wet, smelly $20 you've had in your, by your cleaning in your pocket. Come on.
Blame Publix. I had to get the cash back today, so that's what I got from Publix.
I won $20 because I'm running go for 50 last night. Thanks, Bron, for slowing down. I guess I should thank Tatum in a weird way. Oh, when we come back, David Griffin. He's back in the building. We'll talk to Griff about the East Finals, his draft lottery experience, and so much more. Don't go anywhere.
Thanks to the Supreme Court for legalizing gambling.
The Starters is brought to you by Jack Daniel's Tennessee Honey, official partner of the NBA.
Guest season stays winning, and we're happy to welcome back former Cavs GM David Griffin. Griff, appreciate you swinging by again.
Hey, guys. Thanks for having me.
We got a lot to talk about here. Let's dive right into the East Finals. LeBron in game two last night takes a shot to the head, to the neck, leaves, comes back. Didn't look the same, some thought, in the second half. Do you think that injury, that neck injury, did affect his play and how the Cavs sort of got going there in the second half and ultimately lost that one?
I think it did. I think it had a big impact on it, and I think it was meaningful that Marcus Smart said post-game that they recognized at that moment that they could really press up on Cleveland and make them uncomfortable. And I think I personally have never seen that look in LeBron's eyes. I thought it was more than a neck strain when I saw it, and I didn't think he was the same in the second half. Even though he was putting up numbers, he was playing first chair violin and not conducting everybody else, and that whole team's built to feed off of him. So if he's not going to be the one setting everybody up, it's going to be very difficult for them to feel comfortable. And I think on the defensive end, Brad's adjustments were really, really good. But I also think that once they got to the point where they had lost some confidence, they weren't making multiple effort plays anymore on defense like they did in the first half. And you get outscored 71-47 from that point on. It had a really profound impact on the group.
For sure. What can the Cavs do here down 2-0 in this series? Are there adjustments to be made from Coach Lou as they head back to Cleveland? Is there something that jumps out to you? What do they do here?
Yeah, I think there are. And I think a lot of it will be predicated upon LeBron's condition, obviously. Sure. But right now, to this point, if you're Ty Lue, Boston held serve. That's what they're supposed to do, and it's not a series until somebody loses at home.
Right.
So what you don't want to do is let it become a series at this point. So go hold serve at home. I think one of the things they're going to need to do is they're going to need to start to run some offense through Kevin Love, play him from the elbows, run some more quick hitting actions that all of the switching that Boston is doing really aren't effective against. And if you can do that, you also have the chance to maybe score when LeBron sits down. And if nothing else, he may need a little more rest the rest of the way than he had gotten so far.
LeBron has been on a couple teams now through his illustrious career here where he has been down 2-0. Some he's been swept, others he's come back. You were on one of those teams. You were part of that 2016 finals team. Yeah, I mean, Cavs were down 2-0, obviously more infamously down 3-1, but when you were heading into Game 3, down 2-0 in the finals, I mean, what was LeBron like? What was being said? What was the locker room like, facing that challenging, task to overcome that?
Well, I think that group really had a confidence that came from knowing they were legitimately really good. And maybe we were delusionally confident as well. But I think knowing we were going home, we felt like we had left a lot on the table in those first couple games. Now, nobody gets outscored by the amount we did and feels good about themselves. But because we had recognized the point in those games where they sort of slipped away. And I think we were so keen to the idea that this is a war of attrition that we didn't really show too much. I think the coaches had kind of settled in on some changes we were going to make, and we didn't show it there. And so knowing we were coming home, we had a confidence level. And again, it proved unwarranted because they ended up getting one of those home games as well. So
Did the Draymond Green suspension factor into the disillusion of confidence that he was out for game five?
Yeah, I mean, certainly it played a role in our ability to continue to believe down 3-1. Had he not been suspended, I still think we would have had that same confidence level. I think the outcome certainly would have been much more difficult to arrive at. But at that point, we had left so much on the table in the games in Cleveland that I think it was really clear we were very, very close and that it was a war of attrition. Steph at that point was very much showing signs of wearing down a little bit physically too. And when you can feel that as a player on the court, you can feel their body language changing. You have the ability to be more confident confident. And I thought that was really clear last night. Boston smelled blood in the water when LeBron got hit. And when you can flip that switch and feel that, it's very profound. And it doesn't matter what we're all sitting here thinking down 3-1. They know it. So.
Also happening last night, we had these finals game too. The draft lottery happened. And I had forgotten about this, but you were the lottery representative. You were the team representative for the Cavs back in 2014. You guys had a 1.7% chance, I think, to win the number one pick. And you were there, and you did it. What was your secret to winning the 2014
there will never team draft lottery? There will never be a nerdier version of anyone on stage. Look at that look. Wow, I mean, that's embarrassing.
What do you remember, though, from this night? I mean, did you guys party after? I mean, those long odds there.
Well, look at how lean I was,
first
of all.
You're looking great.
No, you know, it's funny. The thing that I remember more than anything else was how surreal it was to walk onto the stage there and see all of the guys that were representing other teams and the women that were representing for their teams. It was really profound to be there for that moment. Obviously, Mallory Edens is on stage and Dr. J's on stage. Nobody's looking at the actuary standing next to him, right? So I was able to sort of slide in and slide out of the room, but it was a big deal for me to be up there with Dr. J because really, to a huge degree, he was the reason I felt like I was in the NBA. My birthday present and every year was tickets to watch the Suns play the 76ers.
Wow.
And so that was really a dream come true for me to be part of the world that really he brought me into it to a huge degree. And beating him was kind of cool.
Yeah. And what were your lucky charms on that night? Remind me again.
Yeah, so I had what we called Thor's hammer, which was Nick Gilbert's bow tie in my pocket.
Right.
Nobody else is allowed to wear that. And I had a pin that was my grandmother's pin.
Right.
And that served us well for a long time. You know, it's funny. You think about all the things you do from the standpoint of just sheer idiocy when you're in the process of trying to do everything you can to win, rub this so many times and knock your head. all of the silliness that we were doing, it was, it's fun that it paid off in that circumstance, but I look back at it, I look back on me and that video we showed, and I can't even imagine how terrified I was at that time.
And finally, before we go to break here, last time we had you on, it was around the Super Bowl. Timberlake was performing. We went to commercial and you said, why didn't you ask me my favorite Justin Timberlake song?
Yeah.
What's your favorite
song? No, I was crushed.
I know.
I really was.
Well, let's hear the answer.
Push or Love Girl.
Oh, wow.
I mean, that's a banger. Is there even a question? I mean, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry we didn't ask you last
Hello,
time.
Hello, is this thing on? Yeah. I mean, what are we doing here?
Chris, can't thank you enough, man, for swinging by.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
All right. You on Game Time later tonight. All right, when we come back, Tass and Trey here step into the crossfire to debate the biggest draft lottery's winners and losers. Don't go anywhere.
Welcome to Crossfire, presented by TISO. This is how it works. I'll give these two guys three questions, and at the end of it all, I will declare a winner. Here we go with question one. The NBA draft lottery was held in Chicago last night, and here are the results. For the teams that suffered through bad seasons, they can start to see light at the end of the tunnel in the hopes of landing their next franchise superstar. But which team was the biggest winner from the draft lottery? Here we go.
It's the Sacramento Kings. They got the number two pick. They finally can't screw this one up. There's no way. Luka Doncic.
We'll see.
DeAndre Ayton, whatever one they pick, they finally won't screw it up. And no disrespect to De'Aaron Fox, but prior to him, a lot of screw-ups with the Sacramento Kings. They don't have their pick next year, which is now gone. So they need to get better through the draft. They're the winner.
Let's not overthink it. The draft lottery winner is the draft lottery winner. The Phoenix Suns are picking first for the first time in their franchise history, and they can't mess it up either. They either draft Luka Doncic, who played on the Slovenian national team for their new coach, Igor Kokoschkov, or they pick DeAndre Ayton, who played his college ball in Arizona. Yeah, I said that 80% right, but I think that helped. Either way, the Suns just have to not mess it up, which, like the Kings, we'll see.
Seems like no one can mess it up, but everyone can mess it up at the same time.
That's right.
Okay, question two. Well, it wasn't all bananas and cargo shorts there last night. Who was the biggest loser from the NBA draft lottery? Here we go.
Not gonna front, it felt like the Bulls lost a game 7 last night. It was the perfect setup. Lottery in Chicago. One of the most famous Bulls fans on earth pulled a tiny Bulls name out of a balloon. But then the Bulls dropped from all the way from 6th to 7th. which isn't bad until Zach Lowe revealed that they could have had the number two pick if they would have lost the coin flip to the Sacramento Kings. Once again, the Bulls won too many times this year.
We are the losers, all of us, because the Cavs didn't move up. That means we didn't get more Nick Gilbert towards the end. I love this guy. You know, he's won the number one pick twice in 2011, 2013. He's a great kid. He's not a kid anymore. He's 21 years old.
Oh, man.
This is 3 months after undergoing major brain surgery. That bow tie he's wearing made out of the 2016 Cavs championship floor. Love that guy.
Wow, very close one so far. Question three. Finally, we all like a good laugh. So what was the funniest moment from NBA Draft Lottery 2018? Here we go.
I think it was two grown men sharing the same desk. The Celtics rep and the Sixers rep, including Lou's Elton Brand and Rich Goff. That's a 6'9 man on the right. They're in this little tiny desk because it was custom built for them because one of them was getting the Lakers pick. Both got interviewed. They were finishing each other's sentences. It was strange. It was just a strange sight to see.
Yeah, that was a really close setup. But I also love Luke Kennard's reaction when Detroit Pistons lost their pick to the Los Angeles Clippers. There's nothing he could do about it. There's nothing he could change. So he just had to sit there and, just kind of take it. Like CJ0 said on Twitter, it looks he got seated at a wedding reception table where he doesn't know anybody. We've all been there. You're like, should I eat my Brussels sprouts? Who wants the soup? Somebody pass the bread. Didn't look like fun for Luke Kennard.
Pass the Kennard.
Oh, Trey, well, it wasn't a good night for your Bulls, but guess what? Oh! Even better news for you. You're going over to New
York.
We did it! Go Bulls!
All right, when we come back, you can look at three men sharing one desk as Neely gives us the very solid play. Don't go anywhere. Another huge game tonight. Game two between the Warriors and Rockets. Dubs lead the series 1-0. Rockets really need this one. It's on TNT. I know you'll be watching. All right, we asked you, what was Marcus Morris yelling about? You hit us up on Twitter, hashtag the starters. Trey, you got a few of the best answers.
Yeah, we got this one suggested quite a few times, but you knew it was gonna come up. Stop calling me Markeef! Yeah, it's easy to get confused. How about we were on a break? Classic Friends right there. MJ says, confidence, baby, confidence. That's the way to get on the starters. Ben says, just taking a guess here. Ah! Good answer, but my favorite comes from Clayton, who says, if it ends with a dunk, it's not a very solid play. You're right, Marcus. You're right.
Good point. Let's find out here. VSP, what happened?
Well, he's right. He's right. This one was just a gorgeous pass. We've seen this a lot from LeBron, but it is spectacular. Look at this bounce pass through traffic, and it's a layup.
Oh, nice. Oh, yeah.
Perfect.
Nice.
That's what I call a very solid play.
That was an incredible play. Now it's time for the highlight that wasn't. This is unfortunate. Apologies to J.R. Smith, but this was the only shot he hit during the game. It came after the whistle, and he just chucked it in.
Just start shooting like that.
He kind of does.
Yeah, a little bit.
That was a quick release, too, for one hand.
Yeah.
All right, that's it for us. Thanks to Griff for stopping by again. We'll see you guys tomorrow night, 6:30 p.m. Eastern. Enjoy the game tonight.
All right, thanks for joining us, folks. And remember, don't gamble. Or if you do, get better odds than 1-1 that LeBron's going to have to 50-point game.
Organic bananas on me. Let's go, boys.